Oh, who's a good puppy? Oh, who's a good girl? You're a good girl. You like that? Oh, you're such a good girl. Who's a good girl? Who's a good girl? Is this you? Is this you? You a little good girl? Who's a good girl? Is this you? Oh, you're a good girl. Who's a good girl? Who's a... Good puppy. Oh, you're such a good puppy. You're such a good puppy. Oh, we're gonna treat. Oh, you're such a good puppy. Oh, you're such a good puppy. Oh, you're good. You're
this puppy right here is going to die. We're going to sacrifice him for Satan.
Like that puppy. Puppy, do you like that? You like that puppy? Who's a good puppy? Who's a good puppy?
My master demands blood.
Who's a good puppy? Who's a good puppy? Die!
A quick side note before we begin in earnest is that this video will be in two parts. The first being our Necro's shitty opinions standard affair, and the second being a more constructive style of suggestions that can potentially, with some heavy stress on that word, help the developers build the game. What? Help build the game? You mean it's not done yet? Why, yes, boys and girls, you see, I have one rule. Okay, that's a lie. Like Zote the Mighty, I have many precepts, most of which comprise of nonsense or common sense, like don't try to breathe water. But a rule we will be specifically invoking today is this. If you charge money for it, it doesn't matter what state it's in, it's open for consumer critique as a product. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're going back to Steam Early Access. I've done it before, I'm doing it again. And I heavily doubt it will be the last time. Some people play poker, I buy early access. It's cheaper and more exciting that way. Blazing Bit Games, whose previous entries include an R-type type game from 2011 that features a grand total of 4 Steam reviews, and then nothing for 8 goddamn years. Enter Nightmare Reaper, a game that promises to be a retro FPS in the style leaning more heavily towards Shadow Warrior, Rise of the Triad, and Quake-style play, with procedurally generated levels and weapon drop. And I know some of you are raising some red flags here. Procedurally generated, indie, low poly, old graphics, early access, FPS. Yeah, let me know how highly looked upon Strafe is, and while I did praise Paranautical Activity, its longevity has proven to be quite lacking. The procedural roguelite style tends to not lend itself very well to frenetic action and the careful crafting that we demand from our demon genocide committing simulators, but your boy seems to have a thing for brunettes and hospital gowns. Not really sure where that proclivity could have come from. Your guess is as good as mine. So yes, you wretches and wretchettes, I said let's fucking do this, threw some money at a severely unproven studio, and am dragging you straight into this fresh new hell with Nightmare Reaper. Senors, senores, and senoritas, and of course the ever-so-sexy seniors, are Nightmare Gal, a patient in a mental hospital whose nightly escapades range from questionable to highly questionable. We start our game off in the Elder's Cave of Tutorials, after which we awaken to find out the things I just said. Low pixel objects decorate our shelves, that rug I know for a fact you had as a kid decorates our wall, and a weird water JPEG decorates our toilet. We quickly run out of things to do and see, and decide it's time for a nap. And laying in beds of garlic and orchid, she closes an eye which closes another, and in sleep she dreams of watching and looking and feather clouds dancing, and I'm just fucking kidding! She dreams of face-fucking eldritch horrors and zombie women with a grenade launcher! She dreams of blood and hellfire, death and decay, of a creeping madness crawling up from the earth, malformed in its primitive composition, its mismatched limbs adorning its terrible form, making a poor congress for the troubled terrain it was so determined to tread. And all for naught, unfortunately, as all it meets is the business end of the walking buckshot emporium that is our protagonist. From cave to blue cave to forest with house, to cave that's got a mine motif, to a performance tanking cityscape, down to the sewers and into other sewers, up to Constantine's mansion, and just for good measure because we didn't have enough variety, another fucking cave, we get some 35 levels of procedurally generated mayhem. The levels tend to sprawl out as we would expect those two words to do, but it's not uncommon for levels to be pretty straight lines with only small detours, and it's even quite common for the levels to be filled with halls and doors that lead to nothing but empty rooms devoid of even the ghost of a shell. You see, brothers and sisters and tentacled things betwixt, procedural generation is a bit of a curse. Think with me for a brief moment on The Binding of Isaac. Not only will you see the same room layouts more often than a blonde with bad grades sees her professor behind a closed door, but floor layouts will become familiar as well. Think fondly now of the wonderful Enter the Gungeon, and know now that the story is pretty much somewhat the same. Predictability is never certain, but you can start to glean patterns from the procedures. Much monotony is born from the level design, such is the curse. Where these games tend to shine is their moment-to-moment play, punctuated by their insane variety of items and effects, and capped off with a massive amount of enemies and bosses on offer. Oh, and of course, you know, atmospheric crafting and design. So how does Nightmare Reaper fare thus far? Motherfucking poorly, if I say so myself. Room layout parameters are limited, as is the nature. What this means is that I ended up getting the same rooms with the same enemy composition a hell of a lot, which makes massive portions of the game monotonous in layout, design, and manner in which they are tackled. Go ahead and fire up your imaginations with me one more time. Game starts, caves, okay, not bad. Then more caves. Okay, I mean they're a different color, but the distinction doesn't set them apart. Then we get a nice forest, which is quite lovely. Then another forest with a house thrown in from time to time. It's not a big change, but it actually shows some level progression. Then more fucking caves, only separated by the addition of verticality. It's a mine, after all. Okay, we're done with that, we get a nice city. Huge breath of fresh air. The levels rely insanely heavily on rooms filling up with as many flying shits as they can, and about 12 exploding fat sacks of crap who throw more exploding enemies at you. But hey, at least it's not caves. It's more repetitive than the shit I ride, and it's tanking the absolute fuck out of my performance. But it's some fucking variety. And then sewers. Sewers are just caves. But it's a distinction in the motif enough so that they're acceptable. Sure, they're caves, but there's a big enough difference. And then there's more fucking sewers just now with green hurdy water because fuck me running. Then the aforementioned Constantine's mansion. Not special, but he has a pool and it's pretty imaginative. And finally, we cap off our episode with more fucking caves because fuck you and everyone who looks like you. The flow is awful. Disjointed motifs are made even worse by littering cave levels around for 2/3 of the goddamn game. We can have a lot of cave levels and be fine, but the way the levels are ordered and laid out has zero coherent progression, which I guess for lucid nightmares makes sense, but there's no narrative being explored here, so it doesn't actually work. Despite the poor level flow and procedural generation creating more monotony than however many times I've used that word, the game plays quite splendidly. You don't start out exactly fast, but nobody will call you slow, and hey, bunny hopping is a thing. Gunplay is loud, bombastic, and has very good audio-visual feedback. Verticality doesn't really come into play until the mines, excepting the challenge rooms, and even when it does come up, it's tokenistic and hurts the game quite a bit. You see, every enemy that isn't a stationary baddie spawner has one priority when you wake them up. Close the distance to whatever their attack range is. Excepting pistol boys and shotgunners, this is right in your face. Aside from the guys who want to bring you to them, this will never change for anybody. They want to whip it out and pin your head into a little corner until you're coughing up tapioca. The verticality screws this up because everything is a goddamn 2D sprite. So if you are above or below them, they turn into little cardboard cutouts that you look either down on or up at and disappear hilariously. As every enemy's number one priority is proximity to the psycho with a grenade launcher, all these rooms filled to the brim with so many enemies you can't count them end up playing mostly the same. Some layouts will grant you some good old bunny hopping circle strafing. Others, especially in the city and forest levels, are more like holding S and bottlenecking in doorways. The other option the game likes to throw at you is to lock the door behind you and make you score off with 15 exploding fucks who chuck more exploding fucks at you with only whatever gun you kept from the last level, and it drops 5 goddamn chainsaws throughout the course of you clearing the mess. Which is actually a wonderful segue into talking about weapons.
They fucking suck.
Okay, roll the tape back. The game boasts some 32 goddamn early access weapons, and we have those to base our expectations on. The game starts you off picking up a knife and a pistol, and when the tutorial ends, you pick one to keep. From then on, levels will randomly drop weapons, and at the end of each one, you pick one to bring to the next level. Ad infinitum, end game. Weapons will have differing levels of rarity, level, and abilities. White weapons are just the base weapon. Green have one modified property, such as fire rate, fire damage, etc. Blue have two, legendary have three or four. End level, pick one, keep it, move on. Most weapons will be pretty familiar and mostly serve as variations of specific types. Melee weapons of different types and playstyles, different ways to handle explosives, double barrel shotgun, pump action, auto, you get the idea. Despite that whole variations on a theme thing, they do a hell of a lot of work to try and make each weapon have a distinct visual style, a distinct playstyle, and a distinct effect. Some magic books, however, fill the room with elemental damage, others are more direct. Pistols play different from rifles, from grenade launchers, you get the idea. Some are, in fact, distinctions without a difference, but the overall majority offer multiple playstyles to experiment with to your heart's content. The big issue, however, is that not all weapons or modifications are equal. The auto shotgun is a level 1 weapon, and the base version has a pump capacity, rate of fire, reload speed, damage output, and effective range also high that only the drunken missile launcher surpasses it. I learned this very quickly on playthrough 2. To top that off, it uses the most abundant type of ammo in the game. The game also pretty heavily discourages the variety it tries to offer, as I picked up a legendary revolver, decided to try it out until I ran out of ammo, went back to my auto shotgun, only to find out that it had also magically run out of ammo. And that's when I learned that shotguns and pistols share the same ammo type. Fucking why? What kind of goat fuck thought process would lead you to believe that that's in any way a good idea? Well, once again, it's because of the procedural generation. You can't account for the weapon the player will take, nor the kind of ammo they will need for that weapon, nor could you even count on enough ammo for any given weapon type dropping often enough to make the procedural generation viable. So because of this, weapons are broken down into three categories: light, heavy, and magic. Three weapon types, three ammo types, which means the revolver shares the same ammo as the minigun, which shares the same ammo as the shotgun. It's a band-aid. If they had too many types of ammo, they would either have to flood rooms with ammo, or you'd have to throw away weapons you want to keep out of necessity at the end of levels. So their answer to the question of how do we ensure our procedural generation supplies enough variety is to actually cut down on that variety to the point that not only does the variety not really matter, but that you now have the empirical right and wrong answers for what kind of weapons to take between levels that entirely transcends playstyle. Power-ups are also absolutely murdered by the capital P to the capital G. You can't craft segments where a hidden power-up would be fun event for the player, so the game uses its parameters to throw them just absolutely where the fuck ever it thinks. A major result of that is a lot of starting rooms with three power-ups right next to them, and not enough time to take them far enough to use in the next room. Another big result is that you get rooms that you have to bottleneck, and a power-up is tucked away in a corner or behind a door on the opposite side of said room, and the safest, most effective maneuver is kiting. Not circle strafing like you would in, say, Doom or Quake, but instead, again, holding S and bottlenecking at a door and preventing you from ever knowing the power-up is in there in the first place. And the icing on that little cake? You can't chart a specific path to get that power-up to use in the room on your next playthrough, because guess fucking what? Most of the time, power-ups are not useful in their placement because they aren't placed. The most useful placement I ever got was the walking WMD power-up right outside of a boss door. The worst was that very same power-up in the starting room. Next room had another one, and two rooms later I had still not fought any enemies and the power-ups wore off. The procedural generation is killing the experience. Next up, the game has skills. They're small, mostly meaningless increments that you only really notice once you've amassed so many that the game plays entirely differently. You can get a dash and a double jump, and they're fine, welcome additions. But plus 20% starting magic ammo, the worst kind of weapon? I mean, thanks, but is that really an upgrade when the level is going to drop three ammo types in insane abundance anyway? Said skills are unlocked through a minigame platformer, with a sprite that has a hitbox bigger than said sprite. They're working on this, supposedly. Most of the levels are just more monotonous shit that is tedious to play and made inarguably worse by said bad hitbox. Worse still, there's no music, so when you want to get an upgrade, you have to stop everything you're doing, play a tedious, frustrating minigame, and just generally be unhappy. The music, I find meh. It's generic metal that feels like it's trying to ape what Doom 2016 brought to the table. It fades in once combat starts, and it fades out when it's over. Its high fidelity and clean production doesn't gel with the art style, provides no atmosphere, and just kind of takes me out of the experience even further. Said art style is the worst goddamn pixel art I've ever fucking seen. Levels are built entirely out of small repetitive tiles, the 2D sprites are ugly as sin half the time, and many of them are impossible to tell just what the hell I'm supposed to be looking at. Most gun sprites, however, are actually really good, but I think I've yet to see a game that actually fucks up gun sprites. And I get it. It's early access, and I stress early pretty damn hard. I know you're a small team and all, but goddamn, hire some artists. It's made worse by all the fun little Unreal Engine lighting effects they decided to throw in. Yeah, this game has great ambient lighting, amazing shadow work, and pretty little sparkles that clash in absolutely the most nasty way possible for the 90s FPS aesthetic you're going with. It's kind of hard to craft lighting and shadows and visual effects that match your art style when you're not even fucking crafting your levels. All it does is take the game that looks like a baby's first Minecraft mod, topped with early mockups of Doom zombie sprites, juxtaposed with high production value metal, and made all the worse by future tech lighting effects. Juxtaposition doesn't even quite begin to describe it. Kills the atmospheric crafting, and it all just clashes god-awfully. And what really sucks about that is that these guys know what they're doing when it comes to the atmospheric crafting. The hospital is genuinely unsettling, creeps me the fuck out, and can even be terrifying at times, and there's nothing that can hurt you. That's craftsmanship, guys, and absolutely none of the levels have any of that, because they chose procedural generation over craftsmanship. First-person shooters live and die by two things, their gameplay and the experience outside of button presses that they bring. You want to make an homage to 90s FPSs? Well, I think you need to go back and really study what makes them tick. Doom on ultra-violence with pistol start is doable to 100% completion because each individual level is crafted so that on that difficulty, you are given everything you need to complete that level with a few extra resources if you fuck up. You don't get many fuck-ups, usually like two, but you can still do it. Why is that possible? Because the levels were designed with that intent. Purpose and craftsmanship is what made these games. Doom 1 wouldn't be the same without its grunge and metal ripoffs. Doom 64 wouldn't be the same without its atmosphere. Quake probably would be a completely different game without Nine Inch Nails' audio engineering. Hell, don't even get me started on how many ways you can fuck up blood with just a single tiny change. Purpose in level design and atmospheric crafting are a must in these games. It's what made them great. How the fuck is Paranautical Activity holding up? People are gonna remember Dusk's level opening with a massive fortress and fireballs raining down for a long ass time. How long will they remember generic room layout and nothing separating it from other levels in the segment, and only background separating it from other segments? Not long. Procedural generation commits forgettable, boring, monotonous levels by design, and your handling of weapons won't be enough to shine through that like other games do. Their hearts are in the right place, they have several good ideas, and you can mostly see that they have a lot of technical know-how on how to execute them well, but I think they need to expand their team quite a bit in order for this project to be anything worthwhile, especially when it comes to the complete lack of atmospheric crafting. Guys, you need a bigger team, and maybe to reevaluate some of your ideas for the game. And also, you need to put that cover art on a black t-shirt and tell me where I can buy one. I kind of dig it. Okay, boys and girls, this concludes the Necro's shitty opinion segments. All that will be left will be some more constructive ideas on how to help the game, so if you're not interested in that, feel free to click that little red X.
The show starts in 1 minute. And now, on with the show.
To steal a phrase, you know not what you do. And I'm not calling you incompetent. You are blindly, and despite being well-intentioned, dooming your game to the same obscurity that every other procedurally generated FPS currently enjoys. It's monotonous. It lacks crafting, and it lacks any real memorability. With roguelites, the memorable part is individual runs. You're supposed to complete it multiple times, so different weapons, abilities, and mixtures define each run with an overarching story that is mostly inconsequential. It's goal-oriented. First-person shooters are about carefully crafted experiences, especially ones relying as heavily on atmosphere and gunplay as you are. You really get neither of those with this game. Every weapon is disposable because you have to dispose of all but one at the end of every level. If I were to make any one suggestion that would be most important to the game's success and longevity, it's to dump the procedural generation. Your game is incredibly fun, but it's held back entirely by a lack of level crafting and the fact that because of the way weapons and ammo are built, far too many weapons fall into the category of the wrong choice to keep. You can build 2 billion rooms with all the love and attention that the world could muster, and the procedural generation would still hold the game back. You're making a linear experience, you need to craft one. Otherwise, the monotony takes over and the entire project suffers. Next, you really should consider expanding your team. You're going to need better assets and sprites than I can make in MS Paint. Early access isn't supposed to be an excuse for charging for a proof of concept. You're going to struggle for a very long time with your current team, and you'll just inevitably throw your hands up at the end of the early access period with a subpar product. Now let's talk about atmospheric crafting. There's some, and you've got your head in the right place, and you're on track. Unfortunately though, atmospheric crafting in levels is pretty light, and it never really sounds or feels like I'm in a cave, especially when I get into combat and this clean guitar starts drowning everything out with generic metal riffs. You want this game to be atmospheric, and everything should go to servicing that end. I'm mostly musically illiterate, but let's go ahead and take a look at some ideas. First, let's take your caves, because they're omnipresent. So, you have some slight wind, maybe. Echoing drips of water, maybe some ambient monster noises with high reverb softly playing in the background. Now we're going to do something different, and that is that music will be omnipresent. First, your drums will be prominent, but they're going to be behind some filters. Filter 1, heavy reverb. We're in a cave after all. Filter 2 is a filter that gives the drums this effect that makes it sound like you're listening to them through a wall. Let's get a good beats per minute going, but keep the energy pretty low. We want it ever present, oppressive, just around the corner. Next, we'll kick in the bass and the rhythm. Same factors, high reverb, heavy distortion, low energy, just enough to keep the player moving, driving them to push onward through the impending doom the drums promise. We're probably just going to make some black metal here, but stay with me. We want the guitars to also sound pretty distant, but maybe not like they're coming through the wall like the drums. Maybe do experiment. Now, when we get into combat, those filters fade out and the lead portion fades in, and now you get the full music track playing in all its hellish glory. Low fidelity, high fidelity, whatever you want. When the game detects combat is over, fade out the lead track, fade back in the filters, come back to it all when the combat starts again. And now what you can do is you then make an 8 or so minute track, maybe shorter, maybe longer depending on how you want it to go, with this dynamic play. It's not even a very complicated concept, it's the same one that Super Mario uses when jumping onto a Yoshi. Now you have some music that is omnipresent, is used atmospherically, and the combat kind of brings it all together, creating a chorus, so that now the track is no longer just atmospheric, it's also sort of crafting the level into a song. You can then add small but noticeable variations for 3 or 4 tracks, depending on how many levels are in the segment, and yes, it's all essentially the same song, but it creates 4 distinct experiences, helping set the levels apart while maintaining the shared themes. The music should be a part of your atmospheric crafting, and I say this from a place of personal preference for you know what, but this very clean, high-fidelity track that just fades in and out massively detracts from the atmosphere. You need to get grittier to match the visuals. Experiment. Match not just the quality, but even the style of the music to the levels. Improving your art, music, and atmospheric crafting will keep your game beloved and always part of the conversation, even if the procedural generation causes it to not be played very much down the line. Also, maybe move the levels around. Right now it's incredibly cave-heavy, which is fine for an episode, but maybe do caves, blue caves, mine, forest, small town, big town, sewers, other sewers, and then either the descent or the mansion while dropping the descent. There's no real progression, it's just disjointed cave levels broken up by even more disjointed cave levels. Overall, the game needs a stronger sense of craftsmanship. It needs intent behind it. I'm under no delusions that you will drop the procedural generation, but you have to accept that it's going to hold your game back, and that it could even potentially kill your game. Monotony is a huge problem with the game's layout, and none of it is helped when levels blend in together so goddamn hard. Very little of what is on display right now makes me feel like the game will be better after development, just longer. And a much longer experience will certainly be worth the money, but it won't really spark any memories. I'm the NecroSwanson, and you can go fuck yourselves.